So what that means is that if you have a given crystal, whether it's a BCC, FCC, if it's hexagonal, etc., then you can simply calculate and plot the graph of the surface energies. So this would be this graph. In red, we are representing the surface energy for a given direction. So this is just a two-dimensional cross-section of a crystal. And the length between the center of this construction and the red curve tells you what is the magnitude of the surface energy in that direction. In other words, if this was an FCC crystal, if you were to plot, for example, 001 in this direction, then the length between the center and this point here would be the magnitude of the surface energy for that particular plane, right? And then if you're plotting for 111, 110 plane, et cetera, other points in this graph would simply mean, or the distance between the center to that point would simply mean what is the magnitude of the surface energy for that given plane. So for any crystal, you can calculate this. You can measure them in different ways. And then this can be used to predict the equilibrium shape of a crystal. And how this is done is that basically the wolf shape or the equilibrium shape of a crystal corresponds to the overall lowest energy. What that means is that the integral of the surface energy times the surface of the crystal has to be minimized. Right? So you're trying to find the shape of a crystal where the surface, the overall surface of the crystal, and the corresponding surface energies are minimized, right? Where this product is minimized. So the construction itself, from the practical perspective, is done in the following way. So you take a point in this red curve that represents the curve of the free energy, surface energy. You take a line from the center, and you plot another line that is at 90 degrees to that. So you make a tangent to this curve that represents the surface energy. You do this for every point within the surface energy. So you repeat this. So you take another point in the crystal, let's say here, and then you draw a tangent to this point, etc. So you continue the process until you reach, until you finish the full circle around this curve. And then these curves that you plot, now they're indicated in blue, they will outline a shape. So there will be an internal shape, which will be the equilibrium shape for a given crystal. And you started with the red curve that told you what is the surface energy of the crystal. By this construction, the blue outline here tells you what will be the equilibrium shape of that crystal. Okay? So it's a very, very famous wolf construction. It can be done routinely, and it is done routinely. So if you have a given crystal, if you want to calculate how it will look like when you grow that material, if you know the surface energies, you can predict how the crystal will look like. So in this particular case, it will have almost a square shape with some kind of rounded curves. But for real crystals, for given crystals, these equilibrium shapes obviously have to be calculated in three dimensions. And then you're looking at this integral, not only over the surface or the surrounding of this shape, but you're calculating the entire area. And these are just a couple of examples. So if you have a certain point group, you can calculate what is the arrangement of the atoms within the crystal. You can calculate individual facets, and you can then predict how the shape will look like. Yes?
Drawing tangent lines made the shape of the inside shape. I don't understand where that.
Because
looks like you just drew a bunch of tangent lines, you just redraw the outside curve
again. Not necessarily, because, for example, when you take this minimum point, and that's the main reason, so this here will be below anything that you plot for this point, for example, right? So this point here will be below this one here, for example.
Okay.
Yes. So they will. So when you draw them, they will outline this particular shape, right? So if you do this, and in the problem set there is one example that where you asked to do this, so you basically this will outline most of the shape because it's the minimum surface energy, right? That gives you intuitive understanding, right? So this is the minimum surface, so this facet will be stable, right? But then if you continue to do this because it's a continuous magnitude change in the surface free energy, this will give you a set of tangents, and as a consequence, in this particular case where there is this change in slope, it will give you the change in the shape of the crystal as well. Yes?
In the piece
when we're asked to draw the wood shapes, we're also asked to give the associated Miller indices.
Mm-hmm.
What's that mean?
So when you're asked to give the Miller indices, so what is a Miller index, right? So it's the indication of what is the crystallographic direction or the plane that corresponds to that, right? So you have an equilibrium shape. These facets are certain facets within the crystal, right? Whether it's 001, 110. So you are asked to identify what these are, right? So if you have a specific free energy for a given crystal, when you outline the shape of the crystal, it will have a certain shape that you will get the result from. And then you're simply asked to say, well, what are these facets? So that's the question. Yes? So what does it tell you? So when you calculate the crystal, for example, the shape. So this is an equilibrium shape for a given crystal, right? So you start from the symmetry group, you calculate the surface energy, and then it turns out that for this particular crystal, the shape of the resulting wolf shape, and as a result, the crystal that you grow, will mostly be composed of 100 and 11 planes. What that means is that this particular nanocrystal that we just drew here and calculated as a wolf shape, when you try to synthesize these materials, most of them will look like this. And I will give you an example in a second, right? But there are many synthesis methods, for example, when you start from solution and you simply grow nanocrystals, they will have equilibrium shapes. And what that means is that for these nanocrystals, the surface is, in this particular case, unlikely to be 111 facet, right? So all of the crystals will look approximately the same, and most of their facets will be from the groups that we just calculated. Yes?
How do you go from just the surface plot to a Miller index?
Okay, so maybe this is somehow related directly to the problem set. Maybe we can talk about this during the break. But for example, in a given surface plot, this direction, for example, I'm just giving an example. This would be So this would be the surface energy for, let's say, 001 plane. Right? So the length of this vector, so this would be 001 direction, which is normal to 001 plane. This length here would be the magnitude of the surface energy for 001 plane. Okay? So if I plot a line here, it has a certain angle to 001, and I can calculate then what is that direction. That would correspond to the surface energy of a plane that is perpendicular to that line that I'm plotting. Okay? Okay, so in the problem set, again, you will have to, you're not assigned specific directions, so there is a certain arbitrary choice there, if that makes sense. But once you make a choice, then everything rests. For example, if you have a given shape like this, and I'm just making it up, I don't know if this is a solution or not. But if you say, for example, that this is 001 direction, meaning that this is a 001 plane, then you know all of the other directions, right? So you can calculate that. So this is what you're being asked in the problem set. Okay, so to come back to the question that was asked, what does it mean? So we calculate this equilibrium wolf shape, and when you synthesize these materials, then the material will start to grow, and the facets that are most likely to be formed are the ones that we just calculated. Again, this is an example of, I believe, gold nanoparticles on a specific surface, and when you look very closely, the facets that this material is forming are 100 and 111. And if you calculate the wolf construction and the surface energy in the case of gold, you would see that these are the facets that have the minimal surface energy. So this particular crystal is not spherical. It is not composed of, let's say, 110 planes. It's composed of specific planes that correspond to the equilibrium wolf shape for that given crystal. And I also alluded to the fact that if you, for example, synthesize nanoparticles and nanocrystals, they usually are not spherical. They have very well-defined facets. And again, the shape of this crystal that you can calculate, that you can measure, experimentally verify, when you go back to the image of the calculated, they would correspond to the facets that we calculated. Okay? So this is really nice and powerful, and everything comes from the fact that you're calculating how much of the energy is required to form that particular surface, or how much energy is extra in the material just given the fact that there is a surface state, right? So everything is related to the surface. Okay, so with this, we will end today's lecture. So next time, we will continue the discussion about surfaces. Specifically, we will talk about defects of the surfaces, how do they influence the growth of the material, etc.